what you have also done is to bring Sweden into a different light for all of us to begin to understand the sort of phases it has gone through. Phases about which Stieg wrote and felt passionate and yet needed to protect you from, and therefore could not announce that you were married.
I have the rings. We bought them in 1983 to get married. This is my ring. It's a designer ring, Finnish one. And the other one is plain. Stieg was more plain. So that invasion disturbed our marriage. Unfortunately, earlier the same year, Stieg started to write for the British anti-fascist magazine Searchlight on the extreme right in Sweden, Scandinavia, and Europe. And that made him a target for the extreme right all over Europe. Slowly building up during the 1980s, so that's why we could not get married and formalized, but we wore the rings, and now I wear both of them. So.
But explain about the publication of marriage and why that was such a danger he felt for you, which was part of the decision not to marry.
Yeah. He was trying to protect me by not marrying me, and I was trying to protect him by not marrying him. Because we have this wonderful system in Sweden, and I don't want to contest that. I think it's a marvelous system of the right to information. We have extremely public records. I don't think that should be changed at all. I really like it. But for Stieg and me, it became a problem, given that anyone at any time could find out anything public records. And if Stieg was listed as married, the extreme right wing would do this, would find out who he's married to and where he's actually living. But we arranged it in such a way that he would be unmarried. Of course he would have to list his address, but unfortunately if they came to that address, there was no Stieg Larsson there. There was somebody called Gabrielsson, or all our other 8 to 10 neighbors. So he wasn't there, giving the idea that this could be a false address, or that he was had given the address to somebody who was just taking his mail or something like that. And it was my name on the electricity bills, and the phone was in my name, and the phone was actually a secret number, so it couldn't be accessed anyway. They got hold of that one anyway and called, so we always had an answering machine going on. And funny enough, one of Stieg's, well, not colleagues, but a person he discussed with quite a few times was a woman from the ADL in New York. And he had to inform
her. Anti-defamation League.
Yes, ma'am, that's the one. I don't remember really. He had to inform her by letter. This was before the email times. That when she called, she had to say who she was. She would get to an answering machine. She would say who she was, and then he would pick up the phone. So that's how we did it. And this worked wonderfully well, because the extreme right wing, the home pages and the blogs and the internet developed. And of course they were active on those discussion forums and so on. And they had the most wonderful theories on which man Stieg was living with at the moment.
Because they were convinced he was gay.
Since he was unmarried. Since they've seen him not connected to any woman at all, so it worked wonderfully. We had a lot of fun with this.
Because
and they don't like gays either. Actually, I'm not sure who they like. I don't even think they like each other. It's a sad bunch, but